do have a few announcements to make this morning, so I don't forget. If I tend to wait to the end, what happens is I tend to forget to announce it. But they will not be no Tuesday night service here this Tuesday. It's canceled. Actually, Pastor Horn, who was with us for 9 nights, they're actually having 10 meetings overnight as right by McDonald's. Their 9 is right off the highway. They're actually having prayer starting at 7, but the actual services themselves will start until 7 p.m. Monday. So, you know, if you usually come here on Tuesdays, just head out that way, time is. And then I'd also like to say, Jerry and Billy Sparks, we know we took this offering by no request of our own, was just led to do so. We took up a special offer to them, and they sent a card back to us. I just want to read to you guys because you guys contributed to it. But she said, I just want to drop you a quick note to thank you for the gift. I was touched that you thought of us. Please keep us in your prayers. Your gift will really be helpful at this time. Thank you so much. Love, Jerry and Billy. So thank God for everybody that gives. I believe it's truly a blessing to them. Something else we got going on, you may see some flyers. We've actually got some flyers back there on the back table, and it's also up on the bulletin board. But October 24th, from 10 to 4 p.m., we're actually going to be doing an angel tree sign-ups here. If you know of anybody that, or maybe even yourself, needs some assistance this Christmas. They, like I said, we usually get provided usually 3 gifts and usually some clothes. So that's a big blessing. But normally to do this, a lot of times you actually have to go into Asheville. But we'll be doing them here October 24th. And we'll have a social worker here from 10 to 4 p.m. And then also they'll be distributing the gifts here. It's usually the week before Christmas. But we'll let you know when we're posting exactly when we're going to be distributing the gifts. And today, as I said, it is a baptism service. If you're getting baptized today, if you would, stand up for me. Thank you. Up to embarrassing. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, guys. You'll be seated. During these meetings, there's actually 18. I think it was around 18 people that were saved. And they was from all over. And, you know, hallelujah, that was two that were saved during those meetings. And so glad for that. All treats, no tricks. Hallelujah, we're doing again this year. Now, we're going to do it the same night that Lawrence County does Trick or Treat. I talked to Kate, and right now it's supposed to be Saturday the 29th. So that's about what time it's projected to be. Usually from 6 to just whenever people start coming around, we usually have food here and usually have a goodie bag to give to the kids, too. After baptism, it is Pastor Appreciation Month, and so thankful that we're having a dinner in honor of all our pastors. If all of our pastors would please stand up, all of our pastors, please stand up. Randy don't consider himself a pastor, but he is a worship pastor. And then we got Jesse over there, hallelujah. Of course, their spouses, hallelujah. So thank you for all our pastors. So thank you you know, we couldn't do what we do without the help. And they are truly a blessing in us. One more thing. I said I had a lot of announcements today. We are having prayer meeting Friday. Well, you know what? Actually, take a look out on Facebook about that. We normally have prayer meetings on Fridays at 7. I'm guessing they'll probably just get canceled by the same way. Probably just going down. Time is to be in 10 meetings. Amen? So, everybody get everything. Like I said, this is a good thing. Like I said, this angel tree, it helps out. If you need assistance, you know, bless God, take advantage of it. And it doesn't have a specific income level. Need some assistance or know somebody, grab a flyer, give it to them. It's also on Facebook. You can get all the information there. Amen?
Amen.
Glory to God. Well, are you ready to worship this morning?
Amen.
Amen. Are you stirred up? Amen. Yeah. I'm stirred up. Glory to God. Let's give As they sing this morning, we're going to take up our tithes and offerings, hallelujah, and give and worship to God. 2 Corinthians 9:6 says, remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each of you should give what you decide in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. So I just want to thank you, give cheerfully. Bless God by you being faithful to sow this ministry. We're getting the gospel not only out of the community, but into the entire world. So hallelujah, as you give us, have us with you this morning. I thank you, Father, that you have blessed me. So I give because I love you. I want to be obedient to your word. I give willingly from the heart. I give because I want to fulfill the great commission in this world. My desire is that the good news, the gospel of Christ, be preached to the entire world. But I give a faith. In Jesus' name. Amen. Well, let's just get in with these guys and gals and just lift up the name of Jesus. Amen. Everybody stand up. Come on.
Oh, Save me free, I'm yours. tell you, Beth, that God say, you're rising greater faith. I see your faith rising stronger and more effective power. I see the oil flowing in your heart, shining with a mantle of fire and greater powerful wind. And God is moving. I see this church will rise higher in the powerful fire and glory and deeper realms in the past. Be ready for the greater outpouring and worship. And things is turning. It's been a process. But God is turning things suddenly. Your prayers, don't fear or be afraid. Keep your fire at night. Reach out deeper in the community and so, and you'll see things happen in the supernatural. I see your faith. I see your tears. God will pour in resurrection life. And new oil is flowing nonstop. I see faithfulness. And God is faithful and right on time to do a miracle. I'm shaking things to bring in hope and deliverance in the sudden whirlwind and refreshing in the spirit. Run by faith and get your marker and come and speak. God is putting a bigger hand on this church and revive. Or a bigger thing happen and explosive power you can't contain. You'll see more chain broken and renewed in the spirit. Come receive right now faith. Step in deeper and you'll see a body knowing. God is jumping with joy in the spirit. So be ready. Faith is rising and God will move in stronger. There'll be no room to minister. God will take over and spread revival. So be ready and let go and let God be God. The door is open. Come receive life. This is God's will and this is time.
Amen. Yeah. Hallelujah. Not on. I'm on now. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Well, praise the Lord. He is good. Amen. The Lord is good and His mercies endure forever. You know, sometimes, and like I said today, we're having a baptism service. I just stop and ask myself, why do we do the things that we do? I'm reminded of a story. It was actually something he told a while back, and I just took it and I just started telling it. But, you know, there was a young mother. And she was in the kitchen cooking, and she had a roast, and she cut both ends of the roast, and the little girl asked the mother, saying, Mama, why is it that you cut both ends off the roast? She said, well, you know what? I'm not really for sure. I have to ask my mom. So the young mom asked her mom, Mother, why is it that when you always cook the roast, you cut both ends off? She said, you know what, honey? I'm not for sure. That's what my mom always did. So the mother of the younger mother asked her mom, Mom, how come when you cook a roast, do you always cut both ends off? And she began to laugh, and she said, Honey, it's because my pan wasn't big enough to fit the roast in. I had to cut both ends so it would fit. But you see, sometimes we just do because we've always done it and not really have an understanding of why it is we're doing what we're doing. But hallelujah, today we're doing baptizing service. I don't always say that word right. I'm not known for my correct pronunciation, but hallelujah. So why do we baptize? Why is it that we take part, and after you're born again, is it necessary for you to be baptized? I want to make this statement. Who in here has a garage? Does anybody got a garage? I don't have a garage. I got a carport. Well, you know what? Just by you standing in your garage does not make you a car, does it? Neither does being baptized make you a Christian. Jesus, bless God, when we accept Him as our Lord and Savior, we are saved. Now, I'm going to tell you today that being baptized is a testimony and it's a commandment. Jesus Christ is our example. Amen? Jesus Christ in Matthew 3:13 says that Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by Him. And John tried to prevent Him, saying, I need to be baptized by you. And are you coming to me? But Jesus answered and said to him, Permit it to be so now, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he allowed him. When he had been baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water. Behold, the heavens were open to him, and he saw the Spirit of God ascending like a dove and lighting upon him. And suddenly a voice came from heaven saying, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. You know, it pleased the Father for the Son to be baptized. It's pleasing to the Father when we are ourselves baptized. And it's a principle we see throughout the Bible. We look at the Philippian jailer in Acts 16:29. Then he called for light, ran in and fell down trembling before Paul and Silas, speaking about the jailer. Verse 30, and he brought them out and said to them, Sirs, what must I do to be saved? I'm telling you this morning, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior,
what must you do to be saved? Verse 31, it's the same day. Paul and Silas said to Jairus, they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you'll be saved, you and your household. For whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, it's just as simple as crying out to Jesus in a heart belief that He died for your sins, and He'll come into your heart, bless God, and you'll never be the same. I'm telling you this morning, you can get saved this morning, and you came to watch somebody else get baptized, hallelujah, we're going to baptize you as well. We'll just do it along with them, amen. No greater testimony to that. But what must I do to be saved? Notice He didn't say, well, you got to believe and then be baptized. He didn't say that, but what did they do? If you go on verse 32, then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and all who were in the house. And He took them the same hour and night and washed their stripes. And immediately, speaking about the jailer, and immediately he and all his family were baptized. And now when he had brought them to his house, he set food before them and rejoiced, having believed in God with all his household. So once again, baptizing doesn't save you, but they were saved, and immediately what they do? What do they go do? They were baptized. Hallelujah. They were baptized. Some will argue, though, and maybe you've heard this argument, they get it from Mark chapter 16, 15, about saying that you have to be baptized to be saved. In Mark 16, 15, he said to them, Jesus speaking, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned. And some people say, well, Jesus said right there, you had to be baptized. But can I tell you this morning, there's different baptisms. There is a baptism unto Jesus, hallelujah. There's a baptism with water, and there's a baptism in the Holy Spirit. Jesus speaking here says about you must believe and be baptized and be saved. He's talking about the Holy Spirit coming into your heart, baptizing you into Christ, making you a new creature in Christ Jesus. In 1 Corinthians 12, in verse 12, it says, for if the body is one and has many members, but all the members of one body being many are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body. What's he talking about here? He's talking about in the new birth, we are transformed into God's kingdom. Whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and have all been made to drink unto one Spirit. Jesus is referring once again to the new birth. Are you not saved till you're baptized? No. But what is baptism? It's an outward expression that the old man has died and that the new man lives within you. You are now dead into sin and alive unto God. It's a testimony, hallelujah. It's a testimony to your friends and family and to the world. Romans 6:1 says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Certainly not. How shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? Or do you not know, as many of us were baptized into Christ, Jesus, were baptized into His death. Therefore we were buried with Him through baptism into death. Yet just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should walk in the newness of life. If you've been born again this morning, you are a new creature in Christ Jesus. Now, you look the same. Just because you get saved doesn't mean your appearance changed. If you was bald-headed before you got saved, you're going to still be bald-headed. If you had gray hairs before you saved, you're going to have gray hairs now. Even though you'd be a newborn babe in Christ, it's talking about the spiritual nature of man. You see, man is a spirit being. He lives in a body and has a soul. You see, it is the spirit man that's going to live on. It's the spirit man that's born again. You see, the Holy Spirit comes upon you and bless God and recreates you, takes you out of Satan's kingdom and puts you in God's kingdom. Glory to God. A statement I've heard, and listen to this because it's very true. We may never be martyrs, but we can die to self, to sin, to the world, to our plans and ambitions. All of our lives, for Christians, we should be a martyr to God. Not saying we die necessarily in that we get our heads cut off, so to speak, but in ourself. But to sin, to the world, to our plans and our ambitions, we are a living martyr. Because it is no longer I who lives, but He that's in me. In my life, we must surrender our lives to Him and to His calling. And we are not the same. We were bought with a price, hallelujah. But This is the significance of baptism. We die with Christ and rose to a new life. Hallelujah. Once again, I want to say that again. That is the significance of baptism. We died with Christ and rose to new life. Glory to God. It may seem foolish to the mind. It may not make any sense. Well, you know, I swim all the time. I even took a bath this morning, stuck my head underneath the water. So what's the importance of getting baptized? As we said earlier, it's a testimony to the world. You know, faith, it's your faith speaking out and you demonstrating your faith. You're saying, hey, listen, I know who I used to be. And thank God these two that were saved are young. You know, no better time to get saved when you're young. You don't have as many regrets when you're young. You don't have as much of a past to deal with. And the past for a lot of people is hard to get over. Especially when you're older. You might say, well, you know, I've done so much bad. You know, God can't save me. He can save you and already has. It's just a matter of you accepting what He's done for you. You're not saved by works. It's grace. And it's through faith. It's a gift of God. Hallelujah. And it's so easy. You know, the difference of a few minutes makes the difference in all of eternity. Once again, Romans 10 says, "Through whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." I told this story last night, but I'm going to share it with you again. This is her happened back in the early 1900s, but there was a woman missionary, and she was in the Indian reservations out in the Midwest. And one of the particular fellas that was there, he was a rather large individual, very strong man, but his wife was saved, and the only time he came to church was when he was drunk. Anybody drink before they came this morning? Well, you see, you're not so bad then, are you? But hallelujah. The only time he came to church was when he was drunk. And this woman was preaching one night, and she was up there, you know, ministering to the lost there in the Indian reservation. And here comes that big man. And automatically her jaw just fell to the floor and said, oh my. You see, because what would happen when he came to church and he was drunk, he would turn pews over, he would throw chairs, and he would actually go up and just tear up completely these stands. I mean, he was a character, and they would have to actually call reinforcements in from other counties just to help deal with him and get him out of service. He was so big and strong. Well, she said, you know, her chin dropped to the floor, but she just continued on preaching. She just went on, and in Romans 10, as we said, and said, "For whosoever call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." Kept it real simple. You know, there wasn't much education back in this day and in this particular reservation, so she just taught just like after you was teaching a child. Just kept it plain and simple. And she said she got toward the end of her service, and that big man got up, you know, and everybody's going, ugh, you know, what is he going to do? Here it comes. But they said he walked down the aisle, came down, and got on his knees and cried out three times, "Jesus, Jesus, Jesus," three times like that. And man, nobody even came to help him. Everybody was in just such awe and shock that he was even up there. Bless God, even the deacons just stood there looking, and they finally decided, hey, we better go help him. This guy's been a big, mean, ugly guy. He's going to need a lot of prayer for him to get saved. So they started coming down to pray with him. And about that time, he got up. And they said, "Brother, no, get back down here. You need to pray some more. You've done a lot of bad things. You need to pray some more." He says, "No, I don't. I don't need to pray no more. I'm saved." They said, "No, you don't understand. We know your past. We know you're big, mean, and ugly. You've got a lot of repentance to get back down here." He says, "No, didn't you hear what the minister said?" She says, "Whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. I called on his name three times. I'm saved." He said, "You can get down there and pray if you want, but I'm born again." And that woman minister said, she said, "You know what? I came to learn I don't even believe what I preach sometimes." You know, even as ministers, we're not careful. We won't even believe sometimes what we're preaching. But hallelujah, it's that simple to be saved. It's that simple. And bless God, but you think baptism, even though it is so simple, it is an expression, it's done in faith, but bless God, you're speaking volumes to what it is that God has done for you. Bless God, you're changed on the inside. You're a new creature. Bless God, you've been transformed from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. You was once under the stronghold of Satan, but you are no longer. You are free. Who the Son sets free is free indeed. And I don't care, once again, if you're young or you're old, no matter what you've done, it's not a complicated thing to get saved. God the Father took care of the complicated stuff. All you got to do is come with a believing heart, believing what Jesus Christ He did for you, and then confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord.
Yes.
You know, GEICO says it can save you $300 in 15 minutes or less, but GEICO ain't got nothing on what God can do for you in just 5 minutes or less. But think about that. How many people die and go to hell every day because they simply don't receive the gift that God has for them? Born again or not, salvation is in your lap. Believing is what possesses it and holds it up, but confession is the key to open it up and receiving that salvation. It's that simple. Hallelujah. Matthew 28:18. And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. Lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen." I'm so thankful for these two that gave their hearts to the Lord. Their lives will never be the same. Amen. Amen. We'll never be the same. But hallelujah. As we go down to the boat dock, hallelujah, you know, I want to encourage you, just search your heart. Maybe you're saved this morning and never been baptized. Hey, it's still warm outside. It's a good day. I can remember when I got baptized. It was in December. Joe and Dad, and they was ice so thick on that water down there at boat dock. They literally, what did you get, a sledgehammer? What was it, an axe? Got an axe. It actually broke up the ice so I could get baptized. I'm telling you, today is a lot better day to get baptized than December. But any day is a good day, amen? Any day is a good day. You know what? My life was forever changed. And I was so happy. You know, what a testimony it is. You know, and I know there's people that come once you get baptized that wouldn't normally come. Hallelujah. But bless God, Jesus loves you. And you know what? If you came to watch the loved ones get baptized today, I want to tell you, if you don't know Jesus Christ, Lord, your Savior, you can accept Him today and get baptized with Him. Instead of being a spectator, you get to be a participator this morning. Amen. Amen. If you would, come up here and play, if you can. Hallelujah. If everybody would, if you would bow your heads. That was short and sweet, but you know, I don't believe in complicating things. Say what you want to say and move on. Amen. Glory to God. I'm telling you, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior today, what's going to take you to hell? Well, it's sin that takes you to hell, but more specifically, it's the sin of pride. It's the sin of rejection. If you die lost, you'll stand before God one day. He'll give you the opportunity to prove yourself. Hey, are you worthy enough to enter in, you know, to eternal bliss? What works have you done to earn your salvation? You won't get up there and you're not going to have two legs to stand on. You're like, I have sinned. I have messed up. But God's going to give you that opportunity. You see, the only thing that's going to get you to heaven is accepting just what Jesus Christ has done for you. That's it. It's a free gift. It's a free gift to us, but it costs Jesus much pain and much anguish. But the choice is yours. But you see, you're going to have to set aside your pride. It's that sin of rejection that's going to send you and condemn you to hell. I don't care what you did in the past. It doesn't matter. I've had the opportunity over the past week to get to pray with many people. And so many people are just so broken about all they can do is cry and get out the name of Jesus. But you know what? I always ask them afterwards, did Jesus save you? Yes. Bless God, that confession is made into salvation. But I'm telling you, it don't matter what somebody else thinks about you. It doesn't matter what you did or what you came from. It don't even matter what you're currently in. So many times we think we've got to clean the fish before we catch it. That don't make no sense in the natural. It don't make no sense in the supernatural. You see, just come as you are. For today is the day of salvation. Just come as you are. And then, bless God, when you get saved and born again, there's a benefit package that comes with it. And hallelujah, it's out of this world. When you're born again, then that helper, that comforter, counselor, intercessor, advocate, strengthener, standby, the Holy Spirit, He'll come into your heart. He'll transform your inside. And bless God, that help you need to be free from that addiction, that help you need to get free from that life of sin. You're instantly free from all of that. Word says, whom the Son sets free is free indeed. You don't know freedom until you get out of bondage. And I'm telling you, if you don't know, if you're not part of the heavenly kingdom, you're under bondage. You see, there's two masters in this world. There's Satan and there's God. If you're not serving God, by default, you're serving Satan. You may even say, well, you know what? I've not done very many bad things. I've been a pretty good person. But if you're not in God's kingdom, you're in Satan's kingdom. And Satan is a thief. He's a liar. He's a destroyer. He doesn't like you. And he wants to destroy you and kill you and everybody in your household. He wants to steal from you. But hallelujah, the choice is yours. Anybody today with an uplift hand, say, brother, that's me. I need Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior. Anybody here this morning? Anybody? Like I said, I wish I could make that choice for you, but I can't. Decision's yours and yours alone. It is finished. The work is done. The work is done. It is completed. Salvation is done. The gift is yours. But will you receive it? Will you accept it? Will you let the Holy Spirit come into your life and transform it to never be the same? Anybody with uplift hands, say that's me. Anybody this morning? One last call. They'll sing a final call. Final call. Anybody this morning? You're not promised a second chance. You're not promised tomorrow. Anybody this morning? Thank you guys. Love you. Appreciate each and every one of you. Glory to God. Hallelujah. God is so good. Amen. Amen. He is good. And once again, we're just going to dismiss from here. And as I said, we're going to actually go down, just right down the road, Ridge Creek Boat Dock. Got the two youngins we're going to baptize. And then, like I said, if you've never been baptized or you just want to get baptized, you just feel necessary, maybe you've been astray and you just want to rededicate your life and you just feel it necessary to get baptized again, we'll baptize you again, glory to God. Amen. But if that's you, like I said, we're just going to dismiss from here. Like I said, just head down here to the boat dock and then we'll baptize you. And then afterwards, like I said, today is Pastor Appreciation. We got food. You know, I like to eat. I think everybody else likes to eat too. Instead of having to go in and pay $30 to get something to eat, you know, just stay. Come here, get you something to eat for free. That's the best kind of food, right? There's a lot of food. I always say, if it's free, it's for me. Anybody else like that? But hallelujah. Thank you guys for being with us. We appreciate you. And like I said, let's just head down the boat dock. And then once we get down there, come back up here and get something to eat. Amen.